Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ballpark, Baseball in the American City, by Paul Goldberger, narrated by Mike Chamberlain. Prologue. Whether in a real city or not, when we enter that simulacrum of a city, the ballpark, and we have successfully, usually in a crowd, negotiated the thoroughfares of this special set-aside city, past the portals, guarded by those who check our fitness and take the special token of admission, past the sellers of food and vendors of programs, who make their markets and cry their news, and after we ascend the ramp or go through the tunnel and enter the inner core of the little city, we are often struck, at least I am, by the suddenness and fullness of the vision there presented. A green expanse, complete and coherent, shimmering, carefully tended, a garden. A. Bartlett Giamatti, Take Time for Paradise. The game of baseball may not truly be the ultimate American metaphor. The attempts to make it so tend to be exaggerated, sentimental, and mawkish. But the baseball park, the expanse of green that begins beside city streets and appears to extend forever, is. It is not only that it is a simulacrum of a city, as A. Bartlett Giamatti, the scholar of literature and baseball, who served as both president of the National League and commissioner of baseball, wrote. It is also that it contains a garden at its heart, and as such, it evokes the tension between the rural and the urban that has existed throughout American history. In the ballpark, the two sides of the American character, the Jeffersonian impulse toward open space and rural expanse, and the Hamiltonian belief in the city and in industrial infrastructure, are joined and cannot be torn apart. They no longer represent two alternative visions of the world, as they so often do. In the baseball park, they each need the other. They must coexist. The exquisite garden of the baseball field, without the structure around it, would be just a rural meadow, bereft not only of the spectators themselves, but of the transformative energy they bring. And the stands, without the diamond and the outfield, would be a pointless construction. In the baseball park, we can see how this country expressed a concept of community, and how we imbued the public realm with shared meaning. The baseball park was always a special kind of place, usually privately built and privately owned, but able to instill people with a greater sense that it belonged to them than most places that had been built by their government. This garden in the center of the city, this piece of rus in urbe, was spiritually public, if legally private, and in almost every city, it formed a defining element of the civic realm. As much as the town square, the street, the park, and the plaza, the baseball park is a key part of American public space. We can see through baseball parks how Americans went from viewing their cities as central to the idea of community in the first decades of the 20th century to wanting to run away from them in the decades after World War II, and then how we have tried in our own time to use baseball parks to get our cities back. The first generation of ballparks, places like Union Grounds and Washington Park in Brooklyn, and South End Grounds in Boston, and Sportsman's Park in St. Louis, as well as the ornate and marvelously named Palace of the Fans in Cincinnati, and the still larger Ebbets Field and Fenway Park and Wrigley Field that followed not far behind, grew out of neighborhoods, took their eccentric forms from the pattern of city streets, and were inextricably tied to their surroundings. The story of Ebbets Field is the story of Brooklyn, as the story of Tiger Stadium is the story of downtown Detroit. The second generation of ballparks, places like Shea Stadium, is a different story. Concrete bunkers, often circular, shaped not by the grid of urban streets, but by a backward glance to the ancient Colosseum, an amphitheater built for gladiators not pitching duels. Not by accident, perhaps, were many of them designed to do double duty as football stadiums. Set in a sea of parking, these ballparks were generally built during the years after World War II to escape the city, or at least to minimize any connection to it, and they were invariably suburban in concept, if not in geography. They reveal how far Americans had come in the post-war years from thinking of urban neighborhoods as desirable turf. The most famous of the post-war structures built for baseball, the Astrodome, had a roof that rendered the entire ball field interior space, removing even the fig leaf of roofs in the urbe. And the Astrodome was far from the only ballpark whose builders thought baseball would be better off played on artificial turf under a huge dome than on grass under the sky. And the story changes again with the ballparks of the third generation. Beginning in 1992, with Oriole Park at Camden Yards in Baltimore, new ballparks in cities across the country brought baseball back to its downtown origins, often, as at Camden Yards, quite literally integrated into older urban neighborhoods and returning to the field of grass under the open sky. A few recent ballparks have had retractable roofs, very different from permanent domes. They use technology as a means of avoiding rain postponements, not of cutting all play off from nature. But what is most important about the ballparks of the third generation is that most of them were designed in the hope of weaving together an urban fabric that had been broken, aspiring to use baseball to heal the city rather than to run away from it. Today, more than a quarter century after Camden Yards opened to great acclaim, it still represents our most encouraging model. But the commitment to a vibrant and open urbanism that it aspired to is threatened by the very latest development in ballparks, the movement away from connecting to the real city in favor of envisioning the ballpark as more like the centerpiece of a developer-built theme park. This trend is exemplified by SunTrust Park in Atlanta, which opened in 2017 in the Atlanta suburbs as part of The Battery, a quasi-urban, instant neighborhood of restaurants, condos, bars, and hotels, in which everything, even the streets, is part of a private development project largely controlled by the Atlanta Braves. Atlanta is the most fully realized project of this type, but the idea it represents, the extension of the private space of the ballpark into the surrounding streets and neighborhood, is playing out around older ballparks such as Wrigley Field in Chicago and Busch Stadium in St. Louis, as these teams try to remake much of their surroundings. And it is the blueprint for future new ballparks, like Globe Life Field, which the Texas Rangers are building in Arlington, Texas, to replace Globe Life Park, which opened only 25 years ago, and the new ballpark the Oakland Athletics plan for the Howard Terminal section of the Oakland waterfront. Until these recent developments, it looked as if you could summarize the saga of the ballpark as one of city to suburb and back again. But now, a generation after Baltimore reconnected baseball to the energy of the city, ballparks have begun to move in yet another direction, blurring the distinction between the real city and the artifice of the ballpark. The private realm of the ballpark has pushed its way into the public realm of the surrounding city, competing with it in places like St. Louis's Ballpark Village, adjacent to Busch Stadium. In Atlanta, it has obliterated all traces of the real city in favor of the artificial neighborhood of the Battery, which is, for all intents and purposes, a theme park version of a city. Whether this phenomenon becomes a true fourth generation in the evolution of the ballpark remains to be seen. But these recent developments underscore what has been true of the baseball park throughout its life of more than a century and a half, that it has been an indicator not only of our architectural taste, but also of our attitudes towards cities and community, our notions of public space, and our changing views about the nature of place. The ballpark is one of the greatest of all American building types, and it reveals as much about how we treat our cities today as it ever has in the past. The baseball field is much more than a random piece of landscape. It is a magnificently conceived piece of geometry, a diamond whose dimensions are precisely and brilliantly configured to connect to a marvelous moment of human possibility. Whether it will take more time or less time for a player to run 90 feet to a base than it will to take a ball hit by his bat to be retrieved and thrown to that same base. A baseball diamond is like no other field of play, since opposing teams occupy the same space at alternate times, and every player seeks to reach the same goal, which is to return home. Giamatti has explored this eloquently. Home is an English word virtually impossible to translate into other tongues. Home is a concept, not a place. It is a state of mind where self-definition starts. He has noted that home plate also has a peculiar significance, for it is the goal of both teams, the single place that in territorially based games, games about conquering, must be symbolized by two goals, or goal lines, or nets, or baskets. In baseball, everyone wants to arrive at the same place, which is where they start. In baseball, even opponents gather at the same curious, unique place called home plate. The tense family clusters at home, facing the world together, each with separate responsibilities and tasks and perspectives, each with different obligations and instruments. But the geometry of the ball field is more complex and more subtle than the precisely measured diamond itself. The infield sweeps above the grass diamond in a great arc of dirt, reaching from above third base across second to first, a clearing that marks the transition from infield to outfield, and that makes the green diamond look, from above, almost like the base of a mocha-colored ice cream cone. If the arc marks the bottom of the outfield, its sides are defined by a pair of perpendicular lines that run straight out from third base and from first base, continuing the base paths and extending, at least theoretically, into infinity. These lines mark the distinction between fair and foul balls, and while they usually come to an end where they meet grandstands or bleachers set far out in the field, there is no rule specifying where these grandstands or bleachers can be, or whether they need to exist at all, other than a requirement that they can be set no closer than 325 feet from home plate in right and left fields, and no closer than 400 feet from home plate in center field. The leeway given here, in total contrast to the absolute precision of dimensions in the infield, is critical to understanding the nature of baseball itself and of baseball parks. The outfield is expected to vary from place to place, making the field of play different from one ballpark to another. Often, the dimensions of an outfield were determined by the nature of the surrounding streets of an urban ballpark site. It was only in 1958, during the height of the post-war period of concrete donuts, that the minimum distances were set, a reflection of that era's preference for standardization and its indifference to the particularities, not to say eccentricities, of distinct urban sites. But even the setting of minimum distances did not make all outfields the same. It just invalidated the most extreme variations from the norm. But the most important thing about the absence of a firm definition of the outfield lies in its potential to be infinite. It could go on forever. Just as a baseball game with a tied score lasts until a team scores a winning run, and there is no formal limit to the number of innings. Games do not truly last forever, since something always intervenes, whether it be darkness or rain or an umpire's decision, and the outfield does not truly go on forever, because practical needs to have seating somewhere close enough to see the action, as well as to have an enclosure to separate out paying customers from those outside, mandate a fence someplace. But these are all circumstantial things, dictated by the specifics of time and place. They are not rules. So far as the rules of baseball are concerned, the game could go on forever, and so can the outfield. All other American team sports are played against the clock and limited in time, and played on clearly defined spaces like basketball courts or football fields or soccer pitches. Only baseball has no clock and no limits in space. That absence of limits in time or space, as much as anything else about the game, reflects the rural yearnings that are critical to its nature. As the countryside appears to go on forever, so does the baseball outfield. The connections between baseball and the American sense of open country run deep. They are behind the location of the Baseball Hall of Fame in Cooperstown, New York, a rural town whose role in the development of the sport has been proven to be largely mythological. They were underscored by one of the most beloved of all baseball movies, the 1989 Field of Dreams, in which an Iowa farmer constructs a ball field in the middle of his cornfield, far from anything remotely urban. The field attracts ghosts of celebrated players who appear in fulfillment of the film's mantra, "If you build it, they will come." But the true history of the ballpark has nothing to do with imaginary diamonds in Iowa cornfields. If there is something about baseball that bespeaks a nostalgia for the country, the reality of the game is far more connected to the city. This is a book about how the histories of baseball and the American city have been intertwined for more than a century and a half, and about how the architecture of the baseball park expresses their interdependence. The tie between baseball and the city goes beyond the fact that the true fields of dreams were in Brooklyn and Boston and St. Louis and Chicago, rather than in cornfields in Iowa. Baseball was indeed a city game. But there is also something inherent in the design of the baseball park itself that spans the tension between rural and urban, the two realms of American culture that so often coexist uncomfortably. The baseball park is a metaphor for the joining together of rural and urban. It can be thought of as a place in which the field represents the Jeffersonian ideal of the rural landscape stretching out indefinitely, while the structure of grandstands and clubhouses that surrounds and encloses it represents the Hamiltonian vision of American industry and urban vitality. In the baseball park, the two need each other. The structure of the grandstand exists to allow people to watch what is happening on the field, while the field exists to give the grandstand its purpose. And we might also say that the two parts of the field, the infield and the outfield, replicate the same dichotomy. The infield is the urban world of straight lines, rigid dimensions, and frequent action. The outfield is the rural world of open, easy, sprawling land, quiet but for the occasional moment of activity. For the game to succeed, the two worlds have to work in harmony. In the ballpark, the urban and the rural worlds become one. A word to the listener. There are hundreds of baseball parks in the United States, and many more around the world. This is not a history of all of them, which would be an encyclopedia, not a narrative. I want to tell the story of an extraordinary building type, and what it has meant both for the sport of baseball and for the architecture of the American city. That has meant leaving out many ballparks that are appealing, and emphasizing those ballparks that have meant the most to the evolution of the baseball park and its role in American urbanism. I have focused almost entirely on major league ballparks, a choice I made only to keep the story within manageable bounds. That is why only a handful of minor league and Negro League ballparks make appearances in these pages, even though the full story of minor league and Negro League ballparks is a compelling saga in itself. By the same token, no college or university ballparks or ballparks outside of North America are included at all. And while this book does tell the story of many of the greatest ballparks that are now gone, Ebbets Field, most tragically among them, followed closely by Tiger Stadium, I know that many of the fine ballparks that we have lost are not in this book. But like the ballparks of the Negro League and the minor leagues, the ballparks of the Caribbean and the ballparks of Asia, they matter no less for this. They are just a different part of the story. 1. Brooklyn Beginnings. The first baseball games were played in open fields, but the first baseball park, the first place constructed specifically for the game, with places for paying spectators and surrounded by walls to keep non-payers out, was constructed in Brooklyn, New York, by a politically well-connected entrepreneur named William Kemmeyer, who built it on land he owned, called Union Grounds, on Rutledge Street in the southern portion of Williamsburg. The year was 1862, a year after the start of the Civil War, and more than half a century before another politically well-connected entrepreneur, Charles Ebbets, would open a far more famous baseball park in Brooklyn. Ebbets Field would last for 47 years and become the stuff of legend. Union Grounds survived for barely more than two decades, but its short life belied its influence. From Kammeyer's enclosure, the baseball park was born. Union Grounds marked the beginning of the idea that baseball, the game of infinite space, should be played in an urban structure of very finite space, fitted and sometimes contorted into the urban grid. Union Grounds, constructed on a site bordered by Marcy and Harrison Avenues and Rutland and Lynch Streets, was a green field of play, a thing apart from the city and at the same time intimately connected to it. Kammeyer, whose resources came from a family-owned leather company, did not build his baseball park out of a love for the sport. He was a businessman and known to travel in the social circle of William McGeer Tweed, the notorious boss of Tammany Hall. Like Tweed, he endeavored to present a respectable face to the world, even as he was trying as hard as he could to fill his pockets. Kammeyer preferred to use Union Grounds for the more genteel activities of horseback riding in the summer and ice skating in the winter. The problem was that those activities weren't making him enough money, and he could not afford to maintain Union Grounds as a losing investment. Williamsburg, a prosperous and tranquil enclave early in the 19th century, was, like many parts of Brooklyn and New York, already giving way to the dense, gritty city of the industrial age, and its population was increasingly made up of immigrants whose notions of summer recreation did not include horses. Kammeyer saw that baseball, which in the middle of the 19th century was a game played mainly by a collection of clubs that operated more like fraternal associations than professional teams, was becoming increasingly popular as a source of working-class entertainment and was beginning to be an economic entity as well as a recreational one. It was moving toward professionalism in awkward fits and starts that included, among other things, players paid under the table and, in the case of a team that Tweed sponsored, players who were given no-show jobs on the city payroll. When the Fashion Race Course, a racetrack on Long Island, sponsored an All-Star game in 1858, pitting players from various Brooklyn teams against their counterparts from New York, then a separate city, the track owners charged an admission fee of 10 cents, probably the first time people were required to pay for the privilege of watching other people play baseball. There was potential in this, Kammeyer realized, especially if the game could be played in a place designed specifically for it rather than on a racetrack taken over for the occasion. Instead of charging the team's rent for the use of his field, he would charge the spectators. Kammeyer caught the wave of baseball's steady progress toward professionalism and pushed it forward. In the years before the Civil War, the game, which had been played in various forms in the United States for several generations, was codified into something roughly like modern baseball, as differing sets of rules gave way to relatively consistent practices. For all that some historians of the game would embrace a mythology of its rural origins, baseball's ultimate form would be established more on the streets of New York than in the meadows of New England. It was in the metropolitan sprawl of New York and neighboring Brooklyn that the greatest number of teams was located. According to historians Mike Wallace and Edwin G. Burroughs, there were nearly 100 of them by 1858, and it was through their mutual negotiations that the rules were established. The sport was largely self-governing. In the spring of 1854, the New York Knickerbockers, one of the earliest and most established teams, it was set up with a constitution, bylaws, and a set of playing rules in 1845, convened a meeting at Smith's Hotel on Howard Street with the two other best-known teams in the city, the Gothams and the Eagles, to try and sort out inconsistencies in the manner of play, most particularly the standard distance between the bases. The meeting at Smith's set the distance between the bases as 42 paces, and from home to the pitcher as not less than 15 paces, according to John Thorne, the baseball historian. The first team to score 21 aces, runs in today's parlance, was the winner. 3 years later, the Knickerbockers organized another gathering at Smith's, which by then had moved to new quarters on Broome Street. At this second meeting, the teams agreed to dispense with the rule of 21 aces and instead limit games to 9 innings, with each team having 3 outs per inning. More relevant to the form of the ballpark, the teams agreed to establish the idea of foul territory, demarcating a line that extended from first base toward right field and third base toward left field to determine precisely where a batted ball had to go to remain in play. New York had players, it had a clear set of rules, and it had fans. It also had the major national sports journals, which, by giving extensive coverage to the city's baseball teams, further institutionalized New York's version of baseball's rules as the standard. What New York lacked was wide-open playing fields, since the years of baseball's development coincided with the city's own explosive growth, as blocks of tenements and brownstones and factories, not to mention railroad tracks, spread out over the grid of streets. They made most of New York a city in which the man-made all but squeezed out any presence of nature. It was not just Williamsburg that was changing. New Yorkers from all neighborhoods who wanted to play baseball had trouble finding flat, open space large enough to accommodate the game. Early games were often played in Madison Square, but games were technically illegal in city-owned open space. And while that law may have been enforced only sporadically, the pressures of urbanization, including the presence of nearby streetcars, brought an end to active baseball play at Madison Square by the mid-1840s. The favored locale of many of the region's baseball teams, including Alexander Cartwright's Knickerbockers, shifted to the other side of the Hudson River to one of the area's most popular pleasure grounds, the Elysian Fields in Hoboken. Its owner, John Cox Stevens, began hosting organized baseball games in the 1840s, attracting New Yorkers not only with the allure of his pastoral setting, but with the claim that Hoboken was free of the yellow fever that afflicted New York. Stevens's site was definitely free of the encroachments of the industrializing city. And, as A. Bartlett Giamatti would observe many years later, the very name Elysian Fields evoked classical aspirations to paradise, a metaphor that Giamatti would use frequently to describe baseball. Hoboken would have a decent run as the baseball capital, but it would not remain pastoral for long. Stevens, scion of an aristocratic family with a riverfront estate in Hoboken and a mansion in Manhattan, owned the ferries that transported visitors across the Hudson, and he wanted a larger crowd than baseball could provide. He positioned the Elysian Fields as an amusement park, offering people of every stripe an escape from the pressures of the hectic city, and he gave them a merry-go-round, a racetrack, a bowling alley, and events staged by P.T. Barnum. Bars and hotels were built near the ball grounds, and Stevens was so convinced that he was providing New York with a necessary public amenity that he asked the city for a subsidy, even though Hoboken was outside the borders of New York City and, indeed, of New York State. With Stevens's success at turning Elysian Fields into a proto-Coney Island, whatever wholesome appeal Hoboken's natural setting might have had soon evaporated. It was a place that attracted the less respectable crowds, not to mention respectable folk hoping to pursue less respectable activities. George Templeton Strong, a lawyer and diarist, visited Hoboken from his home in Gramercy Park and reported, "I saw scarce anyone there but snobs and their strumpets." It was, Strong observed in his diary, "a pity it's haunted by such a gang as frequent it." Baseball was hardly the sport of the elite, but neither did the players nor their growing base of fans want to see the game played in the shadow of a raffish amusement park. With more and more teams in Brooklyn, Kammeyer saw that he could provide at Union Grounds a field both closer to home and free of competition from other forms of amusement. Brooklyn, by the end of the 1850s, had so many teams that games were being played on every available plot within a 10-mile radius of the city, according to Porter's Spirit of the Times, which called Brooklyn the City of Baseball Clubs. Many of the clubs were intimately connected to neighborhoods, sometimes even taking their names from local streets like Putnam Avenue and Atlantic Avenue, or local businesses like the Eckford and Webb Shipyard. Brooklyn's rapidly growing, heavily immigrant population, the borough had gone from a population of 25,000 in 1835 to 200,000 in 1855, nearly half of whom were immigrants, sorted itself naturally into localized fan groups for each team. More than any other American game, baseball was built on a geographical and psychological sense of localism. If we take localism to be simultaneously an attachment to one place and fear, antipathy, or competitiveness toward other places, Warren Goldstein has written. And Kammeyer realized that however bitter their neighborhood rivalries might be, the loyalists who rooted for the various clubs had one thing in common besides Brooklyn addresses. They could all become his customers. The 6.5-foot-high wooden fence that Kammeyer erected around Union Grounds was intended to keep non-paying customers out, not to create a dividing line between fly balls that could be caught and those that were out of play, the critical role that ballpark fences would come to play soon thereafter. Kammeyer saw his fence, which was more than 500 feet away from home plate at the far point of center field, a distance no batted ball could reach, as a matter of capitalism, not ground rules. His motivations for presenting baseball inside a fenced enclosure were to attract a large crowd, make money, and yet retain some degree of decorum. The Union Grounds had a covered viewing section set aside for women and their gentlemen companions, a further statement of gentility intended to encourage the attendance of women, whose presence was thought to dampen the raucousness of men. Wherever the ladies' presence enlivens the scene, their gentlemanly conduct will follow. Indecorous proceedings will cause the offenders to be instantly expelled from the grounds, reported the Brooklyn Eagle in praise of Kammeyer's decision to market the Union Grounds as a place of modesty and good manners, where ladies can witness the game without being annoyed by the indecorous behavior of the rowdies who attend some of the first-class matches. Kammeyer knew better than to make the entire place into a demonstration of Victorian gentility. He saw, as Warren Goldstein wrote, that the game appealed simultaneously to the culture of urban streets and to the respectable and newly vigorous culture of middle-class Victorian men. And so there was another viewing section, distinctly separate from the one for ladies and couples, that was set aside for gambling. There, men could smoke, drink, and make bets on the game. Kammeyer had given them the equivalent of a saloon in the open air. He was prescient enough to realize that to market baseball to a broad audience, He needed some degree of propriety, but not too much. He sought to position the Union grounds as a place of mass entertainment, more respectable than the honky-tonk of Hoboken, and yet lively enough to assure that no one would mistake it for a church. Not only was gambling encouraged, Kammeyer had a band playing throughout the ballgame, keeping the crowds entertained. When Kammeyer drained the skating pond and filled it in to create the playing field, he left intact a small, peaked roof structure, something like a pagoda, that had stood at the far end of the pond. It was in what became the outfield, somewhat to the right of center field, about 350 feet from home plate, very much within the field of play. The outfield pagoda gave the Union grounds the beginning of an architectural identity, and its very quirkiness and the way in which its intrusive form made playing baseball on Kammeyer's field different from playing anywhere else established another pattern for early ballparks. They were designed, as often as not, around obstacles, which made for certain eccentricities. There was no expectation that any field would look like any other, and if that meant that play was slightly different from one ballpark to another, that was all considered part of the nature of the game. Kammeyer's other innovations included the provision of a clubhouse large enough to accommodate three teams at a time when most ball fields did not have indoor facilities for any. He provided wooden stands with seating for roughly 1,500 spectators, and there was plenty of standing room around the field. On opening day, May 15, 1862, somewhere between 2,000 and 3,000 people showed up at the Union grounds, according to the Brooklyn Eagle. Admission was free on opening day. Kammeyer charged 10 cents a head thereafter, raising it to 25 cents for major games and changing it permanently to 25 cents when the players began to demand a cut of the proceeds. Kammeyer signed up three Brooklyn teams as regular tenants for the field, the Eckford, Putnam, and Constellation clubs, and for opening day, he staged his own version of an all-star game with two sides made up of members of all three teams, called, presumably for their captains, Manolt's side and McKinstry's side. The game began at 3 p.m. after the band played the Star-Spangled Banner, another tradition that reportedly originated at Union grounds. Manolt's team won 17-15. It is not clear why Boss Tweed, who for several years had sponsored a team called the New York Mutuals, did not immediately move his team to his friend's new field. The Mutuals were unusual among ball clubs in that Tweed provided many of its players with political patronage jobs, allowing the New York City Treasury, in effect, to subsidize baseball, or at least Tweed's portion of it, by paying its players. The Mutuals were one of the New York teams that regularly played at Elysian Fields in Hoboken, where they remained until 1867, the year that John Cox Stevens's heirs, upset by a betting scandal in 1865, decided to ban further championship games. But the decision may have masked other objectives, since by then, Elysian Fields was on the verge of giving way to Hoboken's own increasing urbanization. George Templeton Strong had noted back in 1844 that Hoboken was already becoming built up, and by 1893, a local writer would observe that all of the old Elysian fields have been swept away in the demand for building lots. Eventually, Elysian Fields would become the site of a huge Maxwell House coffee plant. The Mutuals made the inevitable move to Union Grounds in time for the seventh season at Kammeyer's ballpark. Numerous other teams came and went as tenants. The day when teams would build and control their own ballparks was still far off, and the field played host to major games, including many that did not involve its regular teams. Other entrepreneurs, impressed by Kammeyer's success and equally eager to take over the position of Elysian Fields as baseball's dominant locale, followed his lead. Reuben S. Decker did so literally, since, like Kammeyer, he converted a skating pond into a baseball park. Decker's Capitoline grounds in Bedford-Stuyvesant which replaced his Capitoline skating pond, was first used for baseball in 1865. Decker's ballpark was the site of the first stolen base by a player named Eddie Cuthbert, who ran uncontested to second base during a game in 1865, provoking laughter at what was thought to be no more than a stunt. The umpires declared that Cuthbert had violated no rule and that he was entitled to remain where he was. The stolen base had been invented. Capitoline Grounds was also the site of one of the greatest games in early Brooklyn baseball history. On June 4, 1870, the Brooklyn Atlantics defeated the mightiest out-of-town team, the Cincinnati Red Stockings, whose record was an astonishing 89-0. The Atlantics won by a single run, with the 8-7 score bringing to an end the longest victory streak in baseball history. That may be the greatest legacy of the Capitoline Grounds, although Decker did devise a pleasing ground rule. He gave a bottle of champagne to any batter who succeeded in hitting a home run over the top of a small, cone-shaped structure in right center field. More important to the history of ballparks, however, were the four successive structures known as Washington Park, the first of which was opened in 1883 in the Gowanus section of Brooklyn, not far from the Gowanus Canal, with wooden stands that had a seating capacity of 3,000. Its prime tenant was a team with the wonderful designation of the Brooklyn Bridegrooms, so named because several of its members chose to marry shortly after the team was formed. The first Washington Park burns down after only 6 years and was replaced by a new Washington Park on the same site that was constructed to allow room for 8,000 spectators. By 1898, the demand for seats necessitated yet another expansion, and this time Washington Park was rebuilt on an adjacent site with 18,000 seats. It was an oddly proportioned field, since the new site left a historic stone building, Gowanus House, which George Washington had used as his headquarters during the Battle of Long Island, in place in right center field. The fences jogged around it, yielding a very short right field, while center field and left center field were exceptionally deep, stretching 500 feet from home plate. A 1908 renovation added center field bleachers, taking 56 feet off the center field corner distance. The third Washington Park didn't last much longer than its predecessors. Possibly to correct the awkwardness of its layout, an architect, Zachary Taylor Davis, was brought in, one of the first times a ballpark is listed as having been designed by an architect. For the 1914 season, the orientation of the diamond was changed, and new grandstands were built, with seating capacity upped slightly to 18,800. In its fourth incarnation, Washington Park still had an ample degree of eccentricity, particularly in the design of its scoreboard, which stood on legs in center field, requiring the center fielder to run beneath the scoreboard to field a ball that was still considered in play. Eventually, the space below the board was covered in netting, giving it the air of a soccer goal. But to speak of the idiosyncrasies of the fourth Washington Park is to get ahead of the story, since by 1914, Ebbets Field had been built a little more than 2 miles away. By then, baseball parks had become fully and completely creatures of a sprawling, urbanized, and industrialized nation, public gathering places 20 times the size of Kammeyer's original field. They were part and parcel not just of New York and Brooklyn, but also of Boston, Chicago, Milwaukee, Cincinnati, Philadelphia, St. Louis, and other cities, as much an expression of dynamic urban growth as of the quest for an escape into rural pleasures that brought people to the Elysian Fields and then to Union Grounds. They were buildings of the city, through and through, but it was out of the search for a rural ideal that the ballpark came to be. Indeed, the very use of the term ballpark is revealing. As George Vesey observed in his Baseball, the place where the game is played is not the stadium, not the arena, but the ballpark, a homey title claimed only by baseball. And what, in the end, is a park except an exercise of rus in urbe, an illusion of the countryside within the city. It is no exaggeration to say that the very idea of baseball itself is an example of rus in urbe, a way in which city folk might briefly break away from the grit and noise and pressures of the harsh city and indulge in the delight of rusticity. It was not so much a game of the countryside as a device by which the city might sustain an illusion of rural pleasures. Baseball is more closely connected to place than any other major American sport, and for most of the game's history, for all the attempts to tie it to rural America, it has been a game of the city. But there is a paradox at its heart, for it yearns to bring the country to the city in a way that no other sport does. There is something urban about the fixed and limited dimensions of the basketball court or the football gridiron, their even lines bespeaking the pattern of an urban grid, and their borders absolute, like those of an ancient walled city. The baseball outfield, once you get beyond the fixed dimensions of the diamond, is infinite, like the open land of the country. It goes on forever, or at least it wants you to think that it could. But that openness is contained within the ballpark. It bespeaks infinity, yet it is finite and enclosed. At every moment, you are conscious of the contradiction in terms. Cities are set within the larger surrounding countryside, but in the baseball park, it is the country that is set within the city. When it comes to baseball, the urban contains the rural. The desire to bring the country into the city grew strong in the 19th century, as American cities became large and industrialized, and as their tenements filled with immigrant workers who had no opportunity for relief from what was, for many of them, an oppressive and crushing environment. Urban life may have held forth the promise of economic benefit, but it was hardly easy or attractive for most people. It is no accident that the rise of baseball in the early decades of the century came at the same time as two major movements in the history of American planning, the urban park movement and the cemetery movement, both of which were motivated by a desire to improve the city by bringing nature within its borders. Parks offered nature in the form of open space for relaxation and recreation, an obvious counterpoint to the city streets. Less apparent was the connection of cemeteries to city life, but it may have been even more important historically, since the first expansive landscaped cemeteries were in the 1830s, and they prefigured the urban park movement. Places like Mount Auburn Cemetery, outside of Boston, were envisioned not only for burial of the dead, but as pleasure grounds, carefully cultivated compositions of rolling land with ponds and clusters of trees at the outskirts of settled cities, with carriage drives along curving roads to enhance their appeal as leisure destinations. Baseball, parks, and cemeteries were above all forms of psychic escape from the harshness of the city, ways of establishing a connection to nature without physically leaving the city. The relentless growth of the city sparked all three movements. Until the early part of the 19th century, the dead were buried in churchyards or in small cemetery parcels in the center of villages, but churchyards were filling up, and rapid urbanization made it impossible, not to mention undesirable, to expand them. When General Henry A.S. Dearborn designed Mount Auburn Cemetery on 72 acres on the edge of Cambridge, Massachusetts, in 1830, its picturesque design, inspired by Père Lachaise Cemetery at the edge of Paris, was so admired that it was quickly followed by picturesque burial landscapes in Philadelphia, Brooklyn, Cincinnati, Baltimore, and Pittsburgh, among other cities. As with baseball parks, Brooklyn produced one of the earliest and finest examples. Its rural cemetery, Greenwood, which opened in 1838, filled 478 acres, a landscape nearly seven times as large as Mount Auburn's. To Brooklynites accustomed to seeing only dense streets and dirty, dusty, vacant lots when they went outdoors, green wood must have seemed like a revelation, a lush, meandering landscape that could make the city disappear. It quickly became a major tourist attraction. By the early 1860s, when Kammeyer opened Union Grounds, green wood was attracting 500,000 visitors a year, second only to Niagara Falls. They came for carriage rides and for family outings, as well as to bury their dead and to visit the monuments that were built at the more lavish grave sites. What they did not come for, of course, was recreation, since the concept of the cemetery as pleasure ground did not extend to active sports, particularly not to those involving team play. It is not surprising that the appeal of the rural cemetery led directly to a desire to bring some of its amenities closer to the city center, both to make it more accessible to a greater number of residents. Greenwood and the other picturesque cemeteries were, by design, located away from urban centers, making them difficult for some people to reach, and to allow for more active recreation. The problem was particularly acute in New York City, since Manhattan Island was tightly bound by rivers. In 1811, a city commission laid out its numbered grid of streets, plotted from Lower Manhattan up to 155th Street, and while New York's population was not yet remotely in need of that much land, the very possibility that the city might one day fill Manhattan Island set off waves of real estate speculation and made real estate, in effect, a commodity. Would there be any relief from block after block of building lots? The commissioners took the position that the city's ample riverfronts would be sufficient and made few additional provisions for public open space. Within a generation, however, shipping, industry, and freight had come to command much of the waterfront, and with every inch of dry land potentially available for houses, offices, and factories, there appeared to be little opportunity to bring nature into the city. John Randall, the surveyor who laid out the grid, which became known as the Commissioner's Plan, did allow for a few open spaces for public use, but as the city grew, many of them were cut back or eliminated altogether to make way for more developable parcels. The rich had their country houses, where they spent much of the year, and may well have been untroubled by the meanness of public space in the growing city. The less fortunate were tethered to the city, and their lives alternated between overcrowded and dank tenements and difficult workplaces, with the animated environment of the street as their only escape. For all the vibrancy of the New York City street, it is not surprising that many of the 19th century's most thoughtful observers doubted that it was sufficient as a public realm. The appeal of Greenwood Cemetery only deepened the belief that more open space and a greater connection to nature were needed if the city's residents were to have an environment conducive to healthy life. But to truly have an impact on the daily life of the city, a park had to be easily accessible, which Greenwood was not, and available to all for active recreation, which Greenwood also was not. It was clear by the 1850s that the city was growing faster than even the pro-growth commissioner's plan had foreseen. Development was galloping northward so rapidly that it had already gobbled up much of the space Randall had imagined as the city's parade ground between 23rd and 33rd streets, the largest open space he had provided. A small portion of it would remain as Madison Square, where it would become the site of early baseball games. If New York were ever to have a large public space in a central location, it needed to be set aside quickly before it, too, was developed. The poet William Cullen Bryant, who was editor of the New York Evening Post, and the architect Andrew Jackson Downing were the most prominent public advocates of a large public park. 500 acres is the smallest area that should be reserved for the future wants of such a city, now while it may be obtained, Downing wrote in The Horticulturalist in August 1851, arguing that this would provide space enough to have broad reaches of park and pleasure grounds, with a real feeling of the breadth and beauty of green fields the perfume and freshness of nature. In such a park, the citizens would take excursions in carriages or on horseback, could have the substantial delights of country roads and country scenery, and forget for a time the rattle of the pavements and the glare of brick walls. In 1853, the state legislature authorized the city to purchase all of the land between 5th and 8th Avenues and between 59th and 106th Streets, a total of 624 acres. The site was expanded in 1859 to 110th Street, bringing the total to 843 acres, but not until an attempt by the city council to eliminate the portion of the park below 72nd Street had been beaten back, an early sign of the politics that would bedevil Central Park for much of its existence. The story of Central Park has been well told. Designed by Frederick Law Olmsted and Calvert Vaux, it is a brilliant, artificially created landscape, weaving multiple rural experiences into a coherent and masterly composition. More relevant to this story is Olmsted's determination to make the park the property of no single group or class of New York citizens, but a place in which all of them could mingle with an ease that they were unlikely to experience on the city's streets, and were certain not to find behind most of its doors. The park, in other words, was intended to be a democratizing force in urban life. What did that mean for sports and recreation? It was not long before it became clear that the city's commitment to making Central Park a place for everyone did not mean that all activities would be allowed to take place within its borders. Organized team sports were not what Olmsted and the park commissioners favored, and while they recognized that the amusements and the routine of the daily life of the Sicilian and Scotsman are dissimilar, and it would be difficult to prescribe rules that would satisfy these dissimilar tastes and habits, the most that can be attained at the park is to afford an opportunity for those recreations or entertainments that are generally acceptable, and to exclude such as will, though perhaps acceptable to a considerable number, in practice, impair the attractions of a common place of recreation to much larger numbers. Thus, the commissioners of the park concluded there was to be no baseball playing. When ball clubs requested permission to play on the park's open meadow, the commissioners rejected it with vehemence, declaring that organized activities such as baseball would be damaging to the carefully wrought landscape. It seems difficult for the ball players to realize that the large open surface of turf that to the cultivated taste is among the most attractive features of the park can have any other use than of a playground, the commissioners complained. Nothing is more certain than that the beauty of these lawns would soon be lost and that they would be rendered disagreeable objects if these games were to be constantly played upon them. If the play of one club is allowed, others will demand the same privilege, and these clubs are so numerous that if space were provided for the ordinary practice of their games, it would tend to depreciate the attractions of the park to the far greater number who visit it for the refined pleasures that its landscape affords to those who are sensitive to natural beauties. Olmsted, the philosopher king of American landscape architecture, saw recreation not as active sport, but as the process of rejuvenation through exposure to nature. His commitment to the democratic spirit of the park was deep and sincere, but so was his belief that large crowds at organized events were antithetical to the landscape he and Vaux had worked so hard to create. In time, of course, baseball would make incursions into the park, and ball fields would be established at multiple points. Olmsted and Vaux's hope that natural beauty alone would be sufficient attraction was naive at best. But their determination that the park be treated primarily as a natural landscape nevertheless prevailed over time, and it assured that Central Park would never be used for the kind of sporting events that attracted large crowds. The needs of baseball would have to be fulfilled elsewhere. Baseball and Central Park had one critical element in common, the quest for rus in urbe. it was fundamental to the allure of both. Baseball players and their fans, like parkgoers, were urbanites who sought the opportunity to look at grass instead of streets. But it would not be Olmsted and Vaux who would shape baseball's place in the city, any more than it would be the designers of Greenwood Cemetery. It would be William Kammeyer, Reuben Decker, and the builders of the multitude of baseball parks in other cities who followed them, who took the yearning to have a piece of the country inside the city that had inspired the new cemeteries and the new parks, and combined it with the showmanship of sport to create a new and entirely American kind of place. 2. Amusement versus Virtue. Baseball grew steadily through the 1860s and into the early 1870s, as the sport that made its field of play a replication of the rural landscape tightened its hold on the nation's growing cities. While the pressures of development squeezed baseball in its earliest years out of central areas like Madison Square in Manhattan, as the game became more popular and baseball parks grew in size, they seemed, paradoxically, to fit better into the urban environment. Larger structures brought more protection from the surrounding cityscape, and a greater sense of enclosure made the grass of the field seem not like a continuation of the surrounding landscape, as it had been at Elysian Fields in Hoboken, but more an occasion for surprise, a delightful burst of perfect green nature that revealed itself inside an urban construction. But practical factors were even more important. Baseball, which once had no purpose other than to please its players, was becoming increasingly a game for spectators, and, with them, bettors. The city was where the fans were. It was where baseball could flourish as a business, both legitimately and as a venue for gambling. Increasingly, the chief constraint of the urban environment, density, was becoming an advantage. And the baseball park could offer the chance to satisfy the desire for rus in urbe in a different way from the rural cemetery and the Olmstedian park. It allowed visitors to be rambunctious, to be celebratory, to shout and jump and scream. Olmsted's vision, however democratic it may have been, was genteel. The public space created around baseball was democratic and exuberant. If the cemetery and the park were reflective, the baseball park was participatory. The emotional impact of the cemetery and the park depended to a large extent on how well they could make any sense of the city disappear. The baseball park was different. However joyful the glimpse of green grass at the moment of arrival may have been, the overall experience of being in a ballpark was nothing like an Olmsted park. It was never intended to blot out the city and create even a momentary illusion of nature. Most ballparks acknowledged, even celebrated, their role as a part of the urban scene. And, indeed, at most ballparks, the harshest aspect of the city, its industrial underside, was rarely far from view. Land in the choicest urban neighborhoods was unlikely to be made available for ballpark construction, which often took place in outlying, rapidly developing neighborhoods. Factories were often close by, and so was an equally potent reminder of urban life, trains and streetcars. While the intrusive presence of trains and streetcars in the very earliest years of baseball had helped to drive the sport out of Madison Square in Manhattan, that had less to do with the noise, soot, and destruction of the illusion of rural landscape that the trains brought than it did with staying one step ahead of the march of real estate development. A baseball park was rarely going to compete with the most profitable uses of land, and especially not in the earliest years of the sport, when baseball grounds were smaller and existed more for players than spectators. The early baseball grounds near Madison Square were there mainly for sport, not money-making. But soon enough, ballparks were business ventures. By the 1870s, the explosive growth of cities had become the friend, not the enemy, of baseball, which learned quickly to coexist with and even profit from the industrial world of urban expansion. As ballparks got bigger, they were less likely to fit into existing urban cores, and the story of Madison Square repeated itself, since it was usually more profitable to divide land into small lots suitable for housing and commercial uses. Ballparks, like factories and other enterprises that needed large parcels, migrated toward the urban edge. That, in turn, meant that many spectators needed a way to reach the ballpark, which led to a natural alliance between streetcar companies and baseball. Proximity to streetcar lines partially fixed the location of the ballparks, the historian Bruce Cucklick has written. Streetcars brought paying spectators to the ballparks, and teams became so dependent on them that several owners of baseball teams invested in trolley companies, and vice versa. It was natural for transportation moguls to own ball clubs, Michael Gershman wrote in Diamonds. The two businesses, streetcars and baseball, were mutually reinforcing. In an age before the automobile, the streetcar was the only way that large crowds of people could move easily across a city, a necessity as teams were increasingly identified with entire cities and not with individual neighborhoods, and as ballparks became correspondingly bigger. The trolley was needed to deliver these bigger crowds to the ballpark, which in turn gave the streetcar companies a guaranteed source of revenue. The second Washington Park in Brooklyn, built in 1898 between 3rd and 4th Avenues and 1st and 3rd Streets, was just one of many parks that would be financed in part by streetcar companies. Intercity trains were another matter entirely. They delivered not fans, but the teams themselves, enabling teams in distant cities to play each other and, for all intents and purposes, creating the leagues that allowed baseball to become a national network of interconnected play and not simply a series of disparate local teams. For most of the 1870s, the Brooklyn Atlantics could play Boss Tweed's New York Mutuals by traveling just a short distance within New York or Brooklyn. But by 1878, the National League, formed in 1876, had teams in six cities, Milwaukee, Indianapolis, Providence, Cincinnati, Chicago, and Boston, playing a 60-game season. Without the train, there was no way the Boston Redcaps could have played in Cincinnati and returned home to South End Grounds to play the Red Stockings 2 days later, as they did in July 1878. Railroads and baseball, then, grew up together. While their sagas are hardly the same, baseball could not have developed into a national sport without the railway system, but the railroad would have been just as powerful if baseball had never existed. Their histories parallel each other's, and they are noticeably intertwined. Both baseball and railroads were products of the growing industrialization of the United States in the second half of the 19th century. Trains, literally so. Baseball, because watching the game and rooting for a local team, became a central pastime of factory workers in urban neighborhoods. Neither baseball nor the train constituted a major presence in the national consciousness in 1850. But 20 years later, both of them mattered a great deal to the culture and, to an increasing degree, to the economy. Without trains, baseball would not have been a national game. The first two major leagues, which were founded in 1871 and 1876, would not have developed as associations of teams in different cities seeking a system of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.